Chris, how big a deal is it that ex-Trump aide Rick Gates has pleaded guilty and presumably will cooperate with the special counsel?
Well, we don't know is the answer. He has flipped, in effect, and is going to be a cooperating witness for the special counsel. He was the right-hand man to Paul Manafort. One assumes that he's willing to testify against Manafort. Now, all of the charges against Gates and Manafort have nothing to do with President Trump, the Trump campaign, alleged collusion with Russia. Gates may be able, conceivably, and I suspect this is what the special counsel hopes, gets Paul Manafort to flip. But does Paul Manafort either have or is he willing to state anything that would incriminate the president or the people around him? We don't know.
Yeah, it seems like it'll be months before we have an answer to that. On the subject of the school shootings, what's the reaction there in Washington to President Trump's desire to make schools harder targets by arming at least some teachers?
Well, like almost everything in Washington, it's very partisan. A lot of Republicans think it's a great idea. People that are supported by or supporters of the NRA think it's a great idea. There are a lot of Democrats who are very tied to the teachers union who think it's a terrible idea. And it'll be interesting to see how this gets through. Look, these are decisions whether you're going to arm teachers that are really not going to be made at the federal level. They're going to be made at the state and local level. But on the other hand, you're talking about if you arm 20% of the public and private school teachers in that country, there are about 3.5 million, so 20% would be about 700,000. If just the training alone is going to cost a ton of money, then if you're going to give them a bonus, as the president suggested, that's another ton of money. School districts can't afford that. Are the feds going to spend billions of dollars for that? That's one of the problems with a lot of this, is it's easy to talk about these in very general terms. Let's arm teachers. Let's raise the age that people can get automatic weapons or semi-automatic weapons. But the devil is always in the detail, and that's when things like this get ground up in Congress, in the Senate, and the House.
Yeah, and the NRA mantra has long been that the best defense against a bad guy with a gun is a good guy with a gun. And that didn't even work out very well, as we're learning, in Parkland with a trained security guard.
No, it certainly didn't. A shocking story, and you can be sure that the people who are against the idea of turning guns into, or rather schools into areas that not of no gun zones, but gun zones to try to scare off attackers, they point to that and say, look, they had security at MDS High School, and it didn't work. The president's response to that is, look, when you're talking about teachers that are in the school with the students, that know the students, they're going to run to the the sound of the guns, and they're going to protect them. This is going to be a long debate, and it'll be, I don't think we should get ahead of ourselves and think just because the president or some other leader proposes it that it's necessarily going to happen.
Yeah. How much of an issue do you think this will be, Chris, in the midterms? I mean, after all, gun control is risky territory for Democrats, too.
Well, in the last certainly few cycles, Democrats have made the point they support gun control, they support measures to make our schools safer, and of course this always comes up, particularly after another one of these tragedies, but they haven't made it a big campaign issue because the theory has been that people that support gun rights are more likely to vote on this issue than people who support more gun control, that it's not a wedge, single issue for Democrats and liberals. After this latest incident and these incredible students who continue to make it an issue, I think it may be more of an issue in favor of the Democrats and in favor of gun controls this time. We'll see. But I don't think this is one that the Republicans see as a no-lose situation for them anymore.
All right. One last question. President Trump said this afternoon that he's certain that Chief of Staff John Kelly will do the right thing when it comes to allowing Jared Kushner to see classified information while his security clearance is still in an interim status. So what do you suppose that means?
Well, the reason I've got a smile on my face is I heard that along with you, Russ, and I have a feeling that if General Kelly, maybe I'm presuming, but I suspect you had the same reaction I did, if General Kelly wants to stay as White House Chief of Staff, then Jared Kushner is going to keep his clearance, his security clearance, and get access to this top secret information. You could argue whether that's the right decision in terms of government, but the president got off saying what a terrific person Jared Kushner was, how incredibly valuable he was on everything from the Mideast peace talks to other issues that Kushner's involved in, that he's not being paid a dime to work for the government. I don't know that it would be the wisest move for General Kelly to make in terms of job longevity to pull Jared Kushner a security clearance.
Yeah, the message seemed to be pretty clear. What do you have on the program this weekend, Chris?
Well, interestingly enough, and you know, oftentimes with the velocity of news, things change, but the students in Parkland, Florida have really made gun control, gun safety, school safety the premier issue. And going to Tallahassee, to the state capitol in Florida, some of them going to that listening session with the president, we're still going to be focusing on that. We're going to have an exclusive interview with the governor of Florida, Rick Scott, who's been pretty quiet, but came out today with a pretty broad-based package of things to do. And even though he's been a big supporter of the NRA, he's now calling for raising the minimum age to get these semi-automatic weapons from 18 to 21. That's something the NRA opposes. We'll talk to him. We'll also talk to two members of the Parkland community. One is Andrew Pollack. You may not know the name, but he was that parent who was in the listening session with the president and talked in such a raw, open way about the loss of his daughter, Meadow, and how, you know, we fix things after 9/11. Why can't we fix them after one school shooting after another? We'll also talk to one of the students there, a senior at the high school, Delaney Tarr, who, like so many of them, has been just incredibly impressive as she pushes for dramatic actions to keep her and a lot of other millions of school students safe.
Yeah, maybe they'll make something happen. We'll be watching this weekend, as always. Chris, thanks.
Russ, thank you.